Happy New Year, everybody. Ham Radio Now, episode 185, part 1. System on a chip, programming FPGAs for mixed signal systems. Another one of these big complex titles. This is presented by Chris Testa, KD2BMH. It's from the ARRL and TAPR Digital Communications Conference in 2014, which is now last year. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. We have reached the Sunday seminar, the four-hour deep dive into a single subject that happens on, well, Sunday, from 8 o'clock until noon, before everybody gets out of Dodge. And this time we're going to learn a lot about programming FPGAs. That's field programmable gate arrays. Most of you don't need an education on what FPGAs can do, but for anybody who's stumbled onto this video, maybe looking for AC4ZO and me to build another dipole, I'll explain that an FPGA is a big computer processor that can be specialized by you to do what you want it to do. Now, I'm talking about big things. For example, Flex Radio uses FPGAs to run their 6000 series software-defined radios. So they're powerful, but they are also flexible if you know how to write the programs that run them. That's what the field programmable part of FPGA means. Chris Testa is using FPGAs to develop his Whitebox radio. That's Chris and his Whitebox radio there. It's otherwise known as the... I was going to have the echo thing set up here. The HT of the future. All right. Well, he's not going to teach you everything you need to know about designing software for FPGAs, but he's going to give you a good head start. And since this is a four-hour talk, I'm going to divide it into four videos conveniently titled Part 1, Part 2, Part 3, and Part 7. Just seeing if you're paying attention. They're all done. They're sitting online right now, so you can whiz through them as fast as you want. You don't have to wait for me to do any more editing. They're all ready to go. There will be, though, one more video coming soon to a YouTube near you, and that is the Saturday banquet talk by Flex Radio founder Gerald Youngblood, K5SDR. It's titled The Accidental Company, and it is the story of how Flex Radio came to be. Now, I'm going to acknowledge the Kickstarter backers who made the video for the entire DCC possible, but I'm only going to do it here in part one. After that, you're on your own. We'll just kind of flow through the programs. So here we go. There are 108 hams who contributed between $10 and $150 as individuals. And I haven't mentioned this in a while, but I promised them a 30-day window of exclusivity to watch the programs as I put them online, starting way back in September. When I decided not to wait for the first two, the ones on Flex Radio's new APIs, I thought those were important enough news to get them out to the ham community right away. I got a bunch of comments from the backers who say, don't wait, put them all online as fast as you can. And so I did. And if you've been watching them as they come out, you can thank those guys who take the idea of open source to heart. They realized that I can't produce the videos for free. I would if I were independently wealthy. All of Ham Radio Now would just be my gift to the ham radio community because that's what I want to do. But I am not independently wealthy. I pretty much have to earn my keep just like you do. So the Kickstarter backers and the other contributors to Ham Radio Now, let me do that. And thanks very much, you guys. We raised about $8,000 in the Kickstarter, and the individual backers made up over half, $5,000. The rest came from what I loosely refer to as our corporate underwriters, and they were $500 apiece. If you do the math, you'd think you'd count six of them, but you won't hear six names here, and that's because some of them decided to stay way under the radar. Unlike me, some hams just don't need that much of a spotlight. Here, however, in the loosely defined corporate underwriter department are a couple of hams who do need the spotlight.
Adam Curry, John C. Dvorak.
It's Sunday, January 4th, 2015. Time for your Gitmo Nation Media Assassination, episode 684.
This is No Agenda.
Still
shaking. And, yeah, that's their new show. So I'm looking at them live on the internet now, not just playing the same old thing back and forth. Adam Curry is KF5SLN. John C. Dvorak is KJ6LNG. They are hams, but this is not another one of those rinky-dink ham radio podcasts. They are pros. They take on the media, politics, entertainment, anything they want, anybody they want. Sometimes they say something nice about ham radio. Everybody else, pretty much trashed. Adam and John are live on the internet. Let's take a look at their website again. They're live on the internet on Sundays and on Thursdays, twice a week, at noagendashow.com. So you can, you know, play this little thing here and play them back anytime you want. You can find a live stream on Sundays and Thursdays, or you can download them in just about any one of those podcast applications and listen to them on your schedule, noagendashow.com. We are also brought to you by Tapper. Tapper sponsors the DCC, of course. If you're interested in anything digital in amateur radio, hardware, software, data, voice, television, you will be at home here in Tapper. If you're getting a lot out of the DCC videos and you're not already a Tapper member, please consider joining. Stop by their website, tapper.org, and check them out. We're also brought to you by several hams who would like you to check out this group, hackersforcharity.org. Now, that Sony story is going away slowly, you know, the alleged North Korea hacking, but a lot of people are saying couldn't have been North Korea. I don't know about that. But what I do know is that that story has done a lot to reinforce the notion that a hacker is a bad guy. So Hackers for Charity might be fighting kind of an uphill battle to get the positive definition of hacking recognized. And that would be people who use their computer skills to do something good. But that's who they are. Hackers for Charity was founded by Johnny Long. He figured out that he and you could use your computer skills to help out people around the world who really need you, but who can't begin to afford you. So maybe you can help. Check them out right here at hackersforcharity.org. And we are brought to you by these guys, the Amateur Radio Engineering Task Force at aretf.org. So the guys at the DCC are all about creating things. Several of them have worked on new ways to network ham radio systems. And they all pretty much agreed that it was hard to find any kind of standards to guide them. So Kenny, KU7M, and Brian, K7UDR, decided to do something about it. They launched ARETF, modeled on the IETF, the Internet Engineering Task Force. It's a place where hams can get together to document and share ideas on networking and maybe agree on some standards. They're just getting started, so if this interests you, you can still get in on the ground floor. Stop by aretf.org and follow the blog that's right over here. There's 66 people on it so far. I'm one of them. Follow the blog so that you can keep up to date. And finally, we are brought to you by an enthusiastic supporter. I'm too enthusiastic. Of Ham Radio Now and Tapper, who wishes to remain anonymous. One of those anonymous people. This ham is a regular attendee of the DCC for over 30 years. You saw him several times over the many programs we have done. And he is enthusiastic about what the DCC and Ham Radio Now are doing together. So once again, my thanks to all of our corporate contributors. If you didn't get in on the Kickstarter and you want to support Ham Radio Now, well, you can. Just stop by our website. Yeah, right there. HamRadioNow.tv, you will find our mascot, Arvin, the piggy bank, who is also sitting over my shoulder there. And you click on his icon, it'll take you to our contribution page where you can use PayPal or a credit card. And in this program, Chris Testa said something interesting.
I found Tapper from Gary's Ham Radio Now videos on YouTube. And I saw Matt Edis speak, and you know, the PhoneCube dongle inventor speak, and knew that this was the place that I had to come to share this idea.
I'm kind of proud of that. I expect that Chris will have a pretty bright future in technology, and it looks like he's going to dedicate some of his effort, maybe a lot of his effort, to ham radio. It feels pretty special to have played a part in introducing him to TAPR and the DCC. And if you're a part of the Kickstarter, or you've contributed to Ham Radio Now, then you have played a part in the future of Ham Radio too. Who knows who else might discover what's going on here by seeing Ham Radio Now on YouTube. So we all thank you. So now, let's get him back to Austin one more time, or actually, I guess, four more times. Okay, with the Saturday banquet, we'll call it five more times. And TAPR President Steve Bible, N7HPR, will get this Sunday seminar underway. Steve, get me out of here.
So I'd like to say good morning to everybody. And this is the Sunday seminar, and we're really lucky to have Chris Testa this year. And Chris is going to introduce you to system-on-chip FPGAs for mixed-signal systems and introduce you to these fine devices and how to develop for them. And as a reminder, this is somewhat more of a classroom type of setting, and we do have the microphones to capture your questions. So for the interactive part of it, and of course, as Chris goes along, he'll take your questions and, you know, take a moment to grab a microphone so we can capture you on video for all posterity, okay? So take it away, Chris.
Thank you, Steve. Can everybody hear me? Am I on here? Can you guys all hear me? Everybody's good? Awesome. Thanks, George. So hi, everyone. I'm Chris Testa, KD2BMH, and I'm here to talk to you today about a bunch of acronyms up there on the wall. We have systems on a chip, field programmable gate arrays, and something called mixed signal systems. And this is a space that I've been looking at for the past 2.5 years, and pretty much my whole life I've been interested in this stuff, but didn't know that these were the words that, you know, for today, this is where this space is at. And I want to share with you all what I've learned as I've been trying to build this project that I call the Whitebox Project, which I'll talk about, and go into all the pieces that you need to work with the most modern released field programmable gate arrays that have come out. So this seminar is broken up into four 40-minute lectures with a couple of breaks in between. There's one 30-minute break as well, and it'll probably end about 30 minutes early. There's two programming projects that you can do during those 30-minute blocks if you brought your computer. They're completely optional. They require using, they don't require using either Ubuntu or Mac or OS X or Windows. It'll work on all of them, but you have to set up Python and do some work to get it to set up on your machine. And I really only have an installer script to get it to work on Ubuntu. So if anyone wants to contribute that after the fact, I'll happily add it to the code repository, which you guys can check out today. So what we're here to talk about are these things called systems on a chip. This system on a chip is the STM32F. And the way that this was taken, this was done by a group in Russia called ZeptoBars. They take the chips and they stick them in acid, and they keep applying acid to it until they get the raw, what's called the dye. And so this is like when you look at the little black chip, this is what's inside of there and what's going on. And this is like a whole universe. This is a whole circuit board inside of a circuit board. There's these things up here. These are analog sections or little supervisor controllers. The parts down here, there's a little bit of flash hard drive built into it. There's some SRAM in this block right here. All around the outside, these are the peripherals. So this is how your all the pins connect in. And this spot right here is where we're really going to focus what's in here. This is where the processors are and all of the peripherals that are in an STM32F. And what we're going to talk about is how you can build your own stuff that plugs in here, that connects with the processors and all the RAM and everything, and it all fits inside of this really small package. And you know, the chips that you can do this with have been out for like 2-3 years, and a little bit longer than that actually. But at this point now, every manufacturer, Altera, Xilinx, and the one I've been using is Actel or Microsemi, they all have one of these chips or a few of them that you can play with. So whatever vendor you like to use, you can use, you know, whichever one you want. And but what we're going to talk about is a bunch of tools that I ended up building that are all open source. And it's really like most open source projects, an amalgamation of many different open source projects that I combined together to be able to do everything for building an FPGA up until the part where you really need the vendor tools to do that final burn of an image that you can then program onto the device. So that's what a system on a chip is, and an FPGA lets you make your own system on a chip and lets you design the circuitry inside of that. But there's the other part of what we're talking about is mixed signal systems. So the first part of that is signals. And signals convey information. That's like the simplest definition, and it's very clear. That's what a signal is for. And in the real world, there's both analog signals, and we also have created our own virtual universe of digital signals. And when we build, you know, a software-defined radio or work in robotics, we're working on how we interface digital signals with analog signals in the real world. So it's this kind of like interface right there between the two that's very interesting to play with. And what I think is happening right now, which is the evolution, is we're moving from using computers to do virtual things in virtual worlds to manipulating the real world. And it's very easy now to, you know, you can get all the parts to use the computer chips to manipulate the real world. This is robotics, this is software-defined radio, and you know, it's gonna flower everywhere. The other part of it is systems. So systems they take input signals. A system is the whole concept of something that takes a bunch of inputs and manipulates them and then has a bunch of outputs that it, you know, it's kind of like the response. And this is kind of like a high-level block diagram of a mixed signal system. You start with an analog input, it goes into an analog to digital converter, and then you end up with a digital system. Then you have a system that you design, and we're going to focus a lot about how you design a system that works in concert with what's coming in real time and works, you know, affects the real world in real time with low latency, you know, all the things that you need in order to really work with the real world, just like you do so. Okay, so this first section, I'm going to go over who I am, the project I've been working on, how I found TAPR, and then I'm going to give, because as amateur radio operators, we're not required to know how to program, I'm going to give a quick introduction to programming with Python, which is the tool that I used, the language that I used is kind of like a glue to tie all of these different types of systems and all these different languages into one common place where I can just mess with it. So first, who am I? I started ripping computers apart when I was 9. My father's an engineer, my grandfather was an engineer. So I was always around people who were into this stuff, and they let me rip apart calculators, they gave me computers, they let me, you know, I bought my own computer when I was young. At 11, I told my mom that I really wanted to learn how to program C. I didn't know what I was asking, but I got a book called Teach Yourself C in 21 Days, and I read it for the next couple of years. And eventually, I figured out what a pointer was. And we're going to talk about what a pointer is at some point in this presentation. And it's just been a passion for me all my life. So in In 2011, when I was 26 years old, I had my first smartphone, and I was backpacking in Lassen Volcanic National Park. I knew very little about radio. I'd studied computer engineering. And when I was on the top of the mountain, I realized, well, what if I broke my leg? How am I going to let someone know? And I'm so addicted to this smartphone, and it won't work out here. So I started asking, how, you know, what's the reason why this won't work? And that led me to, you know, the amateur radio world, because these are the guys who do have the equipment where they can do that. So a little background. The main things that have really influenced me, I'm an Eagle Scout. So I've been camping all my life. I love going out into the backwoods and not taking the internet with me and just being out in nature. I really enjoy that. I studied at the University of Maryland, computer engineering and philosophy. And then after school, I moved to Los Angeles. I worked at Google and I worked at YouTube. I got to work on cloud computing stuff, which was interesting. And you know, working on the search engine was very interesting. Writing a program that I press enter and, you know, 5,000 computers all started doing something in sync together for me to answer a question that I had was really, really fun. But I've always been, you know, I love ripping apart computers too. So making hardware was something that I really wanted to do. This magazine issue, I don't know who was at the DCC 2 years ago, but this issue of Make Magazine changed my life when I read this particular sentence in this article called Of Kits and Revolutions. And it says, whether in radio, auto, aircraft, electronics, or personal computers in the internet, communities of kit-building talented amateurs, not credentialed elites, have disproportionately influenced early innovation. This room is the amateurs who do that. And that's why I gravitated towards this group. Other things that really influenced me to want to make some sort of smartphone thing was I'm an internet kid. And when there's attacks on the internet, like PIPA and SOPA, and there's a new one every 6 months now, I realized that we needed to eliminate, not completely eliminate the wires from the internet, but we needed to move to more and more wireless technology because it's not centrally controllable. There's no pipe that, you know, the NSA can then download everything from. I mean, they can put receivers all over the planet and listen to everything, but they can't then control and packet switch without jamming the public. So that was something that that motivated me to want to do this. And the other part is I grew up 40 minutes from Tesla's Wardenclyffe laboratory and on Long Island. So I was there one time with my friend. We snuck in. We, you know, broke in. We waited for the security guard to drive around, and we just walked around the halls, and it just really, you know, I was really feeling the whole radio vibe and wanting to do something in this space. So I think it was that night or the night after that we broke into Tesla's lab that I read this article from Eric Blossom called Exploring GNU Radio, and this little paragraph, I know you're not supposed to do this in presentation, put a block of text, but I did it, and I'm just going to read it. We could take some lessons from the internet and push the smarts out to the edges. Instead of cell phones being second-class citizens, usable only if infrastructure is in place and limited to the capabilities determined worthwhile by the operator, we could build smarter devices. These user-owned devices would generate the network. They'd create a mesh among themselves, negotiate for backhaul, and be free to evolve new solutions, features, and applications. And that's when it snapped in my head that this is what I was gonna do. And since then, for 2.5 years, this has been my primary focus. So finding TAPR, I found TAPR from Gary's Ham Radio Now videos on YouTube. And I saw Matt Edis speak, and you know, the PhoneCube dongle inventor speak, and knew that this was the place that I had to come to share this idea. And what's special about TAPR is TAPR's been involved in packet radio, which, you know, packet radio for amateur radio operators is, you know, dying or dead or, you know, it's been dead or whatever you want to say. But this concept of having a terminal, having a radio, and having this thing which is called a terminal node controller that connects them together, it goes way past just what's in an amateur packet station. In fact, and it took me a while to realize this, if you look at a smartphone, this is an iPhone motherboard, an iPhone 4S motherboard. On the top left, this is the terminal, the application processor. On the bottom right, this is the baseband modem. That's the terminal node controller. And then right here, there's the transceiver part. So it's the same, exact same architecture as what we, what amateurs have been using for a very long time to do packet. And so, you know, this is an interesting result to me, an interesting realization that it's really all the same. The architecture is the same over and over again, just shrunk down in your pocket. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about the Whitebox project. In 2011, I think it is now, summer of 2012, actually, I built this prototype with my friend Aaron at the University of Utah. I just bought a bunch of circuit boards, you know, development kits, and got access to a really nice, you know, LaCroix spectrum analyzer at a university lab that's more expensive than my car. And with three computers, five power supplies, and all of this mess, we ended up being able to do a transmission and receive a signal. And that was like the first thing. And that was about 8 weeks before the DCC Atlanta. And so I wrote a paper for it just in time for the deadline and came and spoke about it. So I came with a sheet of paper of a layout that I just threw together in that time. And since then, I built the first version. This is the alpha sitting in my hand. It's backed by four AA batteries. The thing turned on. I could connect with the Linux shell. I could, you know, make it do stuff. But I messed up something called the phase lock loop filter. And I smashed together the nets for the PLL loop filter and the tank circuit for the VCO. And I ended up, you know, just wouldn't radiate RF. So I went in there with an X-Acto knife, cut it up, all these things. And it was a precarious position. It, you know, if I moved it, if I breathed on it, it would stop working. So I decided to build a second one. This is the second version, which I call the Bravo. And this, what you're looking at here is the transceiver portion. So that's the transceiver chip, a CMX991. That's the analog to digital converter, the digital to analog converter. This is the RF synthesizer, and this is the part of the circuit that I messed up on the first one and actually pulled off on the second one. So the status of the project, at this point, both the transmitter and receiver do work, which is really exciting. I've been able to work with the same circuit board now for a year and a half, which is a really nice testament that, you know, the parts that I used and the layout that I did and really did work, and most of the time has really been spent building the tools that we're going to talk about the remainder of the session. I also want to thank Bruce Perrins, who's sitting up here, who's been a really good mentor and ally, who's helped me get the right equipment to actually see what I've been doing. And the main takeaway is that, you know, the chip that I'm using can operate from 50 megahertz to 1,000 megahertz. But when I rip apart every Kenwood and Yaesu radio that I can find, the complexities of building a radio that operates on all modes and all bands is really high. And not only the complexity, but also the cost. So there's some discussion that I want to have with the community about what it is that we're actually going to release, but this is the application processor that I've been using. It runs Android on it, and so I pair that with my transceiver, and that's kind of my initial or my second version of the project. So this is a shot of how I break down, how I'm breaking down all of the parts of the system. And we're going to talk more about using these tree-like structures to be able to understand extremely complicated systems. You can see the top part, the root, there's so much stuff here that I had to put it on two lines. But there's the baseband processor, the transceiver, the application processor, power stuff, case, manufacturing, and then all the testing for QA and FCC. And that's really just the beginning of the ideas of what I think need to be tackled in order to really end up with a smartphone in your pocket that is an amateur radio handheld as well. I think the project's massive, and you know, really the tools that I'm going to talk about for the remainder of the time is how I've been having to think at a higher level about how to build this stuff so we can actually end up with something something that can be engineered. And one of the techniques that I'm going to talk about is using the divide and tactic idea, where you can take a really complex problem, break it down into smaller and smaller problems, solve each one individually, and then at the end, you know, after doing each one individually, you know, as long as you set it up right, the whole thing works when you plug it all in together at the end. If you want to learn more about that, you can check out my website, radio.testa.co, where I have documentation for it. All the source code, all the schematics are up on GitHub at this website. I have a Facebook page if you're interested. And then all the code and all the slides from this presentation are available at this GitHub repo. And we're going to go over this again. So, but if you want and you know how to use Git, you can go ahead and check that out. Or you can just visit this URL and take a look at what we're doing here. Okay, so why are we here? We are here, we're going to talk about programming. And for those who don't like to program, why do I like to program? And I wasn't even really sure, but my girlfriend made me realize that why I like to program is because I like to boss computers around. And programming is really about bossing computers around. And in particular, what we're going to do is we're going to write programs that write programs. That's how you can be very efficient at programming. Not only that, we're going to write programs that make systems, that are going to make this system on a chip. So in order to be efficient with this, there's so much to do. There's so many things that, you know, you can't write it down every single time over and over again in every place. You have to write it down once and then just say, computer, build me, you know, this entire radio. And, you know, and if it's not what you want, you make changes and then have it do it again. Make changes, have it do it again, until you end up with the system that you need. So I had technical difficulties, obviously, and I'm not going to be able to interactively code some Python with you guys today. Thank you, Steve. I'm just going to keep going, I think. But I do have some nice syntax highlighted stuff for us to look at about Python. So the first thing to mention is how low the barrier to entry is to programming Python. All you have to do is install it and then just type, you know, open up Python, and you end up with this thing called the read eval print loop, or REPL. And using this thing, you can just start typing commands. You get this little 3-caret arrow to the side, and you can just start typing stuff. You know, you're not going to turn your computer off. You're not going to blow your computer up. You know, you have to try very hard to do something that's really going to affect your computer in a bad way. You can try whatever you want doing this. And in particular, a nice thing about using the interactive Python shell is you can just type help and in parentheses put whatever it is that you're thinking about, and it'll bring up a nice, you know, explanation, and you can include documentation in your source code and it'll pop up right there. So it's really helpful if you're like lost, like, oh, what's the parameters that I need to pass into this function? Just run help on it and it'll tell you exactly what you need to do. So the first, the very basics is there are things in Python. There are, you could call them scalars, or you could call them, you know, right here there's a number, right? And I type the number 42, and what it does is it reads that expression, it evaluates it to the number 42, it prints the result, 42, and then it loops and lets you do it again. And you can do it over and over again. Here I did another example of printing a string, right? The expression in this case is just the string hello world. You can then assign these scalars to variables, these things to variables. So I can assign the variable x to the number 42, I can assign the number y, or the letter y to number 1, and I can add them together and end up with the number 43. All right, so that's, you know, that's how you can kind of build up little things. This is how you define a function. So a function is where you want to take a set of expressions in a row, and then you want to be able to, you know, you just type that one thing and say, hey, run this, all of these expressions for me. And you can pass in what are called parameters, or in Python we call them arguments, into that function. So I can pass in the letter A, or you know, the variable A and the variable B, and return the sum of the two. When you see the three dots on the side, that means that Python knows that you want to continue this statement. The statement's not done. And it knows when you put the two colons at the end that that means that you're continuing a statement. And Python is, it's case, or it's indentation sensitive. So if you've used other languages like C, where the indentation of where you are doesn't matter, with Python, you need, if you have four spaces on your line where you start the line, the next line has to have four spaces, or else the Python interpreter will not know what it is that you're doing. And ideally, it gives you an exception and tells you, oh, you know, this isn't right. But worst case, it, you know, just silently continues on because your indentation is makes sense for another way to interpret your program.
So indentation does what curly braces do in other languages.
That's right. Indentation is what is like curly braces in C. So, and then the one other thing is after, when you're done with an expression, you enter a blank line. You know, so if I'm doing this indentated part, I enter a blank line, and then when I press enter, it realizes, okay, it's done with this expression. And I can then call my function with the numbers 42 and 1 and end up with the answer 43. So it reads the function, it evaluates it, it prints the result, and loops back. That's the pattern. You can make your own things. To make a thing, you call it a class. This is like other object-oriented languages. In this case, I created a thing called my class, and it has two methods. When you have a function inside of a class, you call them methods. And the first method is called underscore underscore knit underscore underscore, and this is a like special syntax. It's like a constructor in C. And when you create one of these things, that function gets called. It can get passed in a parameter. It gets curried with this parameter called self. And what that means is it's like the this pointer in C. So every time that you call a function or call a method on this class, you get a you get passed in a pointer to the object itself. And the word self, it could be anything. It doesn't have to be self. You could use this, but it's just common in the Python lingo to use the word self. And so in this case, I create an object, I create an instance of my object, my class, and I set its member x to the number 42. And then notice how it printed in init. So when I ran this expression, or when I entered this expression, it ran this function, and part of that function had the side effect of printing that line. So, you know, these are kind of like the interactive things that you can do, and then I can call my method, and again, you know, the same example of being able to add some stuff together. The idea here is not to, you know, you got a question?
No variable declaration.
I'm sorry?
No variable declaration.
There's no variable declarations in Python. There's no there's no worrying about, is this an integer or is this a string or is this, you know, there's no type checking or anything like that. Or spell checking, right? So this whole discussion is not to give you, to turn you into a Python programmer. It's to just give you an idea of the syntax. I got another question back there. Yeah.
Just so I understand that self equals x a little better. If I were to pass as an object an array of things,
right,
then it would automatically, what would m be? When you say self dot x equals x, if I pass an empty array of five things, then is m now equal to that empty array, or is it equal to a pointer to that array? Or,
Python only falls apart when you execute it. As long as the syntax is correct, it'll only fall apart as you run it, and then all of a sudden you'll see, oh, there's an exception. I tried to add an array to a number, and it doesn't know how to add an array and a number together.
You could define that.
You can, yes.
There could be another method, for example.
Right, there's a whole...
It's that one to each element in the array or something, but I guess what I'm saying is that, what is M? Is that a pointer? Is it a handle? Is it...
M is a...
object itself.
M is an... in Python, they use what's called binding. So M is a name.
Okay.
And M is... it's not a pointer, but it references this object that is in memory.
So it's an object reference, like a file handle or it's the same kind of...
Right. There was another question. Did I get it? People are okay?
Python 2 or Python 3?
I'm using Python 2. Python 3 apparently no longer has a print statement. There's a really convenient tool to convert Python 2 to Python 3, but day to day I make money in the web world, and no one in the web world is on Python 3. And the tool we're going to use called MyHDL, I don't think it supports Python 3 yet. So I'm using Python 2.7 for this talk. Okay, so speaking of lists, so now we're going to talk about lists. And this is like the really important part. There's a couple of things in here that maybe you haven't seen, even if you program Python. So to make a list, you put it inside of these brackets. So this is a list of three items. A equals the list 0, 1, and 2. I can grab the first element in that array, and it's got the value 0. There's also a method called len, which gets the length of the array, and there's a whole slew of other ones. There's a function that I use pretty frequently built into Python called range, this is a typo. Range returns 0, 1, 2, not 1, 2, 3, and range, range is like a way where, so whatever number you put here, if I put 10, it would return the numbers 0 to 9. As a list.
And those are not type, they contain any item.
Yes, and they can be heterogeneous as well. So you can put you can have numbers and strings and objects all in the same list. The other type, common type of bag or list option in Python is called a dictionary, or a hash table in other languages. And with this, you use curly brackets to declare one. And in this case, instead of indexing by number, you index by a string. So I create a dictionary B has three things in it, foo, bar, and baz, and each one is associated with the number 0, 1, and 2. And then this dictionary has a bunch of built-in methods. One of them is keys, and that returns the list of all of the keys, you know, all of these parts in this dictionary, or I could get all the values and it returns a list of all the values built into it. And then there's this other one called the in operator. So I can see, is foo in B? And it'll return true or false. You could ask if anything else is in it. And it's very fast and efficient to do these sorts of things.
The values come out in the order that you've got to understand. Because it's a hash table, you don't know what order you're going to open up.
That's true. Yes.
If you run what's on the slide, you get something.
Yeah, so in the real world, you can use something called an order dictionary. If you would like to have the order that you put them in to be the order that they come out. Otherwise, it will, it's based on the hash of these strings. So it'll use, you might not get them back in the order that you put them in.
And behind your back there is a unique string table, so who always has the same thing again?
That is also correct. Yeah, the number 42 is the points to the same thing no matter where you reference it in your program. But that's kind of more devil's in the details aspects. Okay, so the next thing that you want to do is you want to iterate over all of the things in a list. So if I have range 3, and this time it's right at 0, 1, and 2, I can say for each thing in this range, print, you know, that some, you know, I times 2 or I plus itself. And in this case, it'll print 0, it'll print 2, it'll print 4, and then ask you for the next statement. Then there's this thing called a list comprehension, which I use a lot. It's just a little mnemonic that for something that you do frequently, which is iterate over a list of things and make a new list out of it. So in this case, I said, for each thing in this range, create a new list of it plus itself, and I got a new list of 0, 2, and 4. So this is a way that you can quickly, and it's quick and efficient, where you can loop through things and add, you know, create a new list based on an old list, and then there's all these functions called zipping and all these other things that you can use to merge them together, and it's all really pretty fast and efficient. Okay, so here's the part where your brain might hurt and where you gotta hold on, because we're gonna use this a lot. There's something called a generator in Python. So imagine if you wanted to make a list of something where you didn't know everything that's gonna be in the list beforehand. Like, you wanted a list of every number between 0 and infinity. And so if you did it, you know, if you said range of, you know, 100 billion, what it would do is it would create in memory an array of 100 billion things and would end up crashing your machine because it would run out of memory. So there's this thing called a generator that lets you interactively create the stuff. So each time it asks, hey, what's the next one in the list? Hey, what's the next one in the list? And the syntax, there's some special sugar to do that. It's called the yield statement. So in this case, I made my own generator called myRange, which behaves just like range. And it starts with I equaling 0. And then while I is less than this final number that you passed in, it yields that number and adds 1 to I. So what is this thing? If I say, hey, give me my range of 3, it doesn't return a list. It returns this thing called a generator. And the generator is this abstract concept that every time it gets called, it retains its state. So let's see what it does. So for I in my range, what that does is it starts by calling this function, and it starts executing statements until it sees a yield. And when it sees a yield, it returns back that number. So it would return back 0 for the first iteration. And then it would allow it to do whatever's here. So in this case, I'm not doing anything, because there's enough complexity of what we're talking about besides doing more stuff there. And then after it's done with that one, it'll go back right after this statement and start executing from here. And it'll, you know, add 1 to 0, and then it'll check the while statement, and then it will yield 1. It'll go to the next one. And it'll keep doing that until it's done, and when it's done, it when your function ends, then it stops running the loop.
So, like the practice slide I put up the other day, the part that is actually the programming block is the part with an I in it, in the start, no, go down, the arranger.
Yeah.
And that block, just that little I, is being run iteratively.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. So, I think that's the end of that section. Yeah, ask questions about this for a minute.
This is while I am less than final. Is less than the only choice there?
You could use less than or equal to, but then you would also get the final number to come out as well, which wouldn't copy. Yeah.
You have that option in terms of line.
Absolutely, yeah. You can do less than equal. You can do equal, equal. You can pretty much all of the... All the operators from C are available here. Other questions about this? Yeah.
This may be way off topic, but if you were doing this as part of pulling data in off, say, a serial port,
right?
Is this a non-blocking function? In other words, it does the one loop through, gets the one or the zero, and then it can go do something else. Like check the serial port for the next number, or
you would control that. You would put your serial port if you wanted to have a serial port blocking thing in here. You'd put it in there, or if you want it to be non-blocking, yeah. You could have a non-blocking flow as well, and then you would just if you were yielding stuff and there was nothing to yield, you could yield nothing. You know, none is the word that you use to yield nothing. And then you could just check, did I yield nothing? Oh, there was nothing to look at for that iteration.
That's correct. So you could use that as a serial port read or a GPIO read or something like that, and it wouldn't block. It would just check.
It blocks if you want it to block. Yeah.
So when you get to blocking IO, Python has green threads.
Okay. Green threads?
Yeah, that means if something's going to block, mm-hmm. Python will yield the processor to the number of its threads.
Oh, okay.
Go ahead.
Yeah, so how does it help you? Say my range 10 billion, how does it behave nicely?
Because then you don't have to create an array in memory of all 10 billion things. What it does is it just asks you each time, hey, what's the next number? And so you only have to have one number in memory.
One number at a time. So for that expression, the comprehension is complete. Where does it put the temporary value?
Oh, so in this place, for the comprehension to complete, I am putting the numbers into a list, you know, just to show as an example.
Yeah. Chris, this is a concept sometimes called lazy evaluation.
Lazy evaluation.
Of a sequence.
Right.
And you only need to use as many elements of it as you want. You don't need to generate the whole list. It doesn't generate anything before you need it, so it doesn't do any wasted generation.
Right, exactly. And we're going to end up using this when we run simulations with MyHDL, and we'll talk about that later. So that's why this is important. Anything else? Yeah.
Just want to make sure I understand the structure. Within the while, the indentation coming back to the beginning, that tells the while that you have...
It's done.
...back on itself.
Yeah, so...
You'll basically have to put an end or whatever in there to tell it
right.
You're finished within the loop area.
Right, yeah. If you had another line right here that was at the same level as these lines, it would consider that as a continuation of the function. Okay. So, just quickly, if all this was Greek to you, for me, the way that I learned how to program was by just reading lots and lots of programs from other people. And that's why open source is amazing and why I learned so much was because I sat around and read the Linux kernel, I sat around and read every tool that I could find that I used. And you know, the best way to learn is by example. So you can read my code, maybe not the best example, but you can read my code, you can read anyone else's code, and that's the way to really learn. Another critical thing about programming, and it's same like electrical engineering, it's all about patterns. There are a bunch of patterns, and we're going to talk about a couple of them, that you just use over and over and over again. And if you can recognize those patterns, you end up being able to see the structure of the program much better. And last but not least, I won't say the website that's in my head, but just Google things. And you can find anything. If you have a question about, you know, some error that you're getting, just copy that exact wording into Google and see what other people have experienced with that. I do this all the time. You know, I don't know everything. I have like 20 screens open with every reference and every website that I can find and every example, and it's like a slow knockdown to get through. So a book that I really love called The Artist's Way, that actually got me to quit my job at Google, talks about the way to be is to just do it. You know, it's the Nike saying, but just program. If you want to get better at programming, just do it. Find something that you want to solve. It could be something incredibly simple, and just keep programming. Find something to make you want to do it. And you know, the other thing which I mentioned before is we're going to use divide and conquer for the remainder of the talk to break down an incredibly complicated system into its subparts. So I think, okay, we're right on schedule. So here is your 10-minute work if you're interested for the 10-minute break. You can either bring up a Python shell on your screen, or you can go to this website, shell.appspot.com, and your goal is to write the Fibonacci sequence instead of as a recursive algorithm using a generator. And if you just want to look at the answer, you can go to you know, my source code repo for the project, and you can see the way that I implemented it. So, okay, so I'll bring it up on here. It's at github.com. Oh, I'm not on the web, but I'll just type the URL here. github.com/testaco/DCC2014. So you can check that out, and we are on 10-minute break. So I'll see you all back, or you can ask questions. I'm going to stand right here, but if anyone wants to use the restroom or whatever, we're going to take a couple minutes.